To everyone, it's a pleasure to be a part of this wonderful gathering. We are going to talk about how to deal with ocular surface diseases. Very basic things. We're not going to go into anything very advanced or complicated. So when we talk about ocular surface diseases, we know it's like a vast, vast ocean. And there's this whole hierarchy of ocular surface diseases, which includes the very basic ones, starting from blepharitis, meibomian gland disease, also the Demodex these days, which is really causing a havoc, and dealing with them is becoming an issue at times. Allergic eye diseases like VKC with a shield ulcer and a plaque, the gelatinous limbitis that we see, persistent epithelial defects, chemical injuries including the acid attack victims that we see, the alkaline injuries, the acid attack victims especially, you know, are the difficult ones to treat. They need a lot of psychological support along with the other medical management that we carry on for them. So going ahead with from the chemical injuries, it's the severe dry eyes like in SJS and OCP, and of course OSSN, which is becoming much commoner these days. In OSSN, one has to know and decide as to, depending upon the location and the amount involved, whether one would like to go in for a medical treatment, a surgical treatment, or a combination of the two. When we come to the functional effects at the ocular surface, it's very important to know that the clinical signs are very common to most of the diseases. So once you evaluate these patients properly and look out for some specific clinical signs like chronic punctate keratopathies, filamentary keratopathies, recurrent erosions, PEDs, infectious keratitis, melts, management would become easier if one knows what to look for. So we have to understand what is the basic ophthalmological assessment, and it includes a proper assessment of the facial skin, the periocular skin. So you start doing a broad daylight exam without doing a slit lamp first, then go on to the slit lamp examination looking for every part, the lids, the lashes, the punctae, look at the meibomian secretions, the tear film quality, look at the tear film breakup time, punctate staining of the cornea. Look at the bulbar conjunctiva, starting with look for any shortening of fornices, that would be the earlier signs that one would see. Look for keratinization, presence of simblephora. Look for the cornea for any focal wetting abnormalities. Evert the lid, look for the tarsal conjunctiva. Do a Schirmer's with without anesthesia, test the sensations, and of course do a rose bengal stain if no surface stain is found with fluorescein. So once the assessment has been done properly, and the functional effects have been established, it is then very easy to go straight and hit at the bullseye by doing a proper strategic following for the patients. So the most important is to eliminate any exacerbating factors, like you'll only use preservative-free eye drops, remove any kind of glaucoma preservative medications that the patient may be on, shift him to the non-preservative ones, treat the blepharitis, the eyelids, the adnexa, look for protection in the form of lubrication for the patient, might need to go for punctal occlusion, but again punctal occlusion can sometimes be a double-edged sword, so we need to be very careful here. Almost all of these patients will have a bad ocular surface inflammation, so proper use of topical steroids, oral steroids, anti-inflammatories, maybe oral immunosuppressives may be needed. Managing persistent epithelial defects is again very important, because if you don't manage it on time, you might land up in melts, you might land up in microbial keratitis and many other things. Therapeutic contact lenses work very well for patients like SJS and other patients of severe dry eyes. In the surgical management, we have many, many options now. There are newer options coming up by the day. We now have slit in different forms. We can do a cadaveric slit in an acute case so that, you know, you can at least tide off the crisis and then go ahead and do a proper slit again. You have mucous membrane grafting. You have minor salivary gland transplant depending upon the case. I'll just end with this one short video, where it's a case where there was a very bad vascularization, pannus, the cornea was barely seen. So first, of course, we do a peritomy, and the vascular pannus covering the cornea is totally excised. Once the proper excision is done and you've exposed the surface, put an amniotic membrane graft over it, secure it properly with the help of fibrin glue. And once you've secured it well with the fibrin glue, you take a limbal biopsy from the contralateral healthy eye, if you have one at that time. And this is just like at the time where you're putting the amniotic membrane. Trim off all the excess with the help of Vanna scissors. And then take the donor limbal tissue, held it gently, section it into 8 to 10 small pieces with vanas, or you may also use a Teflon block and cut it over that. It depends upon the surgeon comfort at that time. And these are typically stuck in a circular fashion, in a circumlinear fashion, with the help of fibrin glue. And at the end, one could just put a bandage contact lens. So when you have a contralateral healthy eye, yes, autologous SLET works very well. When you don't have, you may need to go look out for a donor, maybe a sibling, but then you have to put the patient on a immunosuppressive. Thank you.
So just one question, can I have for the live donor you are talking about? So it's better to have a sibling, or sibling. You, do you do matching anything?
No, there's no matching at all.
Not required.
You just use a sibling, but you have to have an oral immunosuppression.
So any blood
right
group will be fine.
Absolutely, all right. Nothing.
So the next topic will be.